My name is Rhonna Woolery. I'm the chair of the District 6 Planning Council, and we want to welcome everybody to the Ward 5 candidate forum. We are honored to have the candidates here. Incumbent and current is Councilmember Amy Brenn-Mowen, challengers David Glass and David Sullivan Nightingale.
We will begin our questioning with the candidate who drew number one.
I'm David Sullivan Nightingale. I live in the North End neighborhood of St. Paul. We might have a few North Enders out there. Are there any North Enders here? There's a few. Good to see you. I live on Norton Street, and I've lived there for about 10 years, and I decided to run for city council because I really love my town, and I feel I can contribute a lot to it as an engineer, as a parent, as a veteran. I have a lot vested in the community, as you all do, and I would like to be able to use my knowledge, skills, and abilities to help my neighbors. That's primarily why I want to run in the first place, and that's why I'm running today. I decided that I was going to join the Independence Party about 3 years ago and become more involved with politics because I like their platform. So it's a little unusual for someone from the Independence Party to run for office because we're not a major political party anymore. And this is a nonpartisan race, but I decided to run because their platform really resonated for me. So I appreciate you all coming out tonight, and I look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Uju Indijinika, Jawa Nuanini, Makwa Aja Wishkad, Anishinaabe, Kiwabanikag, Algichida, Economic Development for all of Ward 5 and the City of St. Paul. I'm David Glass, candidate for Ward 5 City Council. I greeted you in my language of the Ojibwe. I'm a St. Paul kid who graduated from Johnson High School and hold close the words of my parents and relatives. Never forget where you come from. Pam and I are residents of Ward 5 for over 20 years and are parishioners at Maternity of Mary. For almost 20 years, my wife Pam and I ran a small coffee house and then built a cafe, wedding, business meeting, concession business from scratch. I'm still getting emails and letters from past customers who've had weddings and business meetings at our new places now that we're gone, and they tell me what a great job we did and how great the food and service was. We built it with long, hard work hours and bringing good people around us, some of who worked by our side for 13, 14, 17 years. We were good employers and treated people with respect and dignity. While I finished college, I worked part-time as a therapist at a dual disorder program with addicts and alcoholics. I also worked at 3M as a marketing manager and for the past 20 years as a small business owner. With over 25 years of volunteer work on national, state, local boards, and nonprofits like Minnesota Housing Partnership, the American Indian Chamber of Commerce, Onda Young Center, the United Way, American Indian Elders Lodge, Association for Enterprise Opportunity, the Human Rights Commission, and the National Coalition Against Racism in Sports and Media, I'm ready to bring that skill set to the City Council. I'll bring the same work ethic to the City Council I brought to all of the nonprofits and board I sat on, and also the same work ethic, integrity, and honesty as the owner of a successful small business that catered to building community with free community meeting rooms and a free traditional Thanksgiving dinner every year for anyone who stopped by. I know how to roll up my sleeves, put on my work boots, and go to work. I'm ready to do that as your new Ward 5 City Council representative.
Thank you. Amy Brenn-Mowen.
Good. Okay. Great. Well, good evening, and thank you very much for being here tonight. I see a lot of wonderful, warm faces out in the crowd. I want to thank the District 6 Community Council and the League of Women Voters for organizing this. My name is Amy Brenn-Mowen, and I'm the current council member for Ward 5. I've lived in St. Paul for about 19 years, and my home is in the wonderful South Como neighborhood. I'm here tonight with my three awesome kids who I can't see in the crowd anymore. There they are, Sawyer, Hawken, and Lars, who all attend St. Paul Public Schools. I grew up in a single-parent home with my mom and sister. We were broke, we moved a lot, but through life's up and down, we were really a team. My life's journey has taught me to be resourceful, to be flexible, to be collaborative, and to be appreciative and grateful. I ran 4 years ago to bring new energy, this curiosity, and a female voice to the city council. I promised to be accessible, I promised to enfranchise the community, and I promised to be a bold leader. Through community office hours, 150 miles of lake laps, calls, meetings, emails, Facebook, I have listened to you. I've met you. I've heard your dreams, I've heard your fears, I've heard your concerns. And I'm really honored to serve this very diverse and wonderful ward. I'm proud of what we've accomplished together. In St. Paul, I believe our neighborhoods and St. Paul are moving in the right direction. Together, we've advanced major planning and construction work in Railroad Island. Together, we are investing in 12 new single-family homes in the North End. Together, we saved the homes of 75 of our most vulnerable at Como by the Lake. Every day is a challenge, but every day is also an adventure. I have delivered on my promises, but I am not done yet. I'm seeking a second term to build on this momentum that we have started, and I won't stop until every neighborhood is livable, every neighborhood is vibrant, and every neighborhood is safe. Thank you. I look forward to the debate tonight.
Thank you. Do we have the questions? We have a lot of questions. And for this first question, we will begin with David Glass, then we'll go to Amy Brennemoen, and then David Sullivan Nightingale. The question is, how will you involve people of color in city governance?
So it's important that St. Paul does a better job in bringing people of color into not only city government, but in all aspects of our community and how we work, and how we interact with each other, and how we make decisions. You know, just a few months ago, the St. Paul Pioneer Press wrote a story about the district councils and the lack of diversity. Within that's our most basic level of, you know, community government, and the storyline is that it wasn't representing the communities of color very well. Here in Ward 5, we actually have the highest percentage of people of color and the immigrant population, more so than any other part of the city. It's important that we do that. As an Anishinaabe, as an American Indian, I share a lot of the same values and traditions as the Hmong community. We've been good friends over the many, many years. I've worked closely with the NAACP African American community, with the Pan-Asian communities, with the new immigrant communities. One of my big supporters, Officer Mark Vicadente, you know, Police Officer of the Year, was named that because of his outreach into the communities. You know, I'll visit and I will encourage and I'll make room and help to make room for that kind of participation at all levels of government in the city and also in our communities.
And then the next is Amy.
I think that in order to be inclusive of community of colors and get community of colors engaged in all aspects of local government and beyond, it needs to be part of everything that we're doing every minute of every day. I had a friend one time who talked to me. I've been a feminist since I was born, and in everything I look at through a gender equity lens. And a friend of mine said, you know, if you extend that a step further and add those same questions about equity that you're asking about gender equity, you can be a great advocate for all communities of color. Some examples of things that I've done in my short 4 years in city council are really being a champion for equity in the way that we deliver our city services. We have a complaint-based model of service delivery from police, which makes some sense, but also our Department of Safety Inspections and other city services require that we complain to get services. And so I've worked, and unfortunately, as a result, that results in areas with means get less degree of service than areas that have more challenges. So every day I work to try to deliver equity in the delivery of city services. In addition to that, at every opportunity, I have tried to make recommendations for our important boards like STAR and CIB and Parks Commission to be women and women from communities of color and representatives from community of color successfully. I participated in the Firefighter Diversity Task Force to make sure that we were expanding our base of who we were recruiting to fight or to be in our fire department. I worked with the mayor's office and had some scuffles with my council members to insert term limits on our powerful boards. Felt like we could not have diversity in our boards if the people in those positions of power never turned over. So we've added some term limits to that. In addition, I've had community office hours in the community as well as at the Hmong Elder Care Center and at the Karen Organization of Minnesota with translators to encourage people to participate in their own language and in their own place. And have taken every opportunity to mentor girls, especially girls of color, to encourage them to have a voice in local politics.
Are there any rebuttals?
Well, I've looked at this problem before because it's important to me. One of the first things I proposed was increasing the size of the city council by 4 members to include 2 new wards and 2 at-large members. So to inherently fix the problem, we need to increase the number of representatives on the city council. With the 7 members we have, that leaves us with roughly 42,000 people to represent for each ward. In our ward, that's 55,000 people, so we're above average in population. That would increase the number to 11 council members. We will actively recruit minorities for the planning councils. We made progress last year in our neighborhood. 2 members of our community stepped up. Members of our community who have been involved for a couple of years are now on the District 6 Planning Council. We also groom young leaders, like the ones in the back of the room there, and get them to return to our community once they've graduated college. So a well-educated workforce coming back will be our leadership of the future, and they're going to be coming from this school, I hope.
David Glass.
Just let me add that, you know, to do this kind of work, you have to have some experience and background in handling it. And, you know, I've sat on the Human Rights Commission appointed by Mayor Randy Kelly. And since Norm Coleman's time, I've worked with leadership from all of our different communities in promoting expanded contracts for people of color and women-owned business. And still today in St. Paul, we have less than, you know, 15% of contracts that are let out go to minority and women-owned businesses. And we can do, and not only can we do a better job, we have to do a better job. It's still, you know, today, we're still lagging far behind the norm in terms of those kinds of contracts and vendor contracts.
Amy Brendemann?
And I would just challenge that. I think that we can always do better with our outreach to minority-owned businesses, women-owned businesses, and increase the number of contracts that we've let. But I believe that the facts show that we've met or exceeded goals that have been set by our human rights organization, and that data is on the city's website. And projects recent projects that we've done, such as the CHS field, among other large projects.
Thank you. The next question will begin with Amy Brendemann. Then David Glass, and then David Sullivan Nightingale. Will you vote yes or no on the Grand Avenue parking meter issue? Explain your answer.
Well, that seems to be a question that only one person here can answer right now. But I guess I would like to say that right now that issue is not on our agenda. It hasn't been inputted, but while I try to go into our public hearings with an open mind, I have been meeting with residents and businesses from the Grand Avenue area, and I have to say I'm not convinced that parking meters are absolutely impossible or not a workable deal. But I do believe that in order for them to work on Grand Avenue, there needs to be buy-in from the residents and from the businesses on Grand Avenue. And right now, that clearly doesn't exist. So if, for example, the vote was tomorrow, I would vote no.
David Sullivan Nightingale?
No.
And would you explain your answer?
I don't want to have to pay a couple bucks to buy an ice cream cone from Izzy's, or, you know, get some cinnamon from the local store there. Yeah, that's awfully expensive for a quick trip. That's going to hurt businesses for sure. I can see it downtown. I think I looked at downtown and compared with the prices for, you know, $10, $20 to park downtown. It makes sense, you know, if you're only stopping in for an hour, pay a buck, and then go into a restaurant and come out. But it doesn't make sense on Grand Avenue. The economics really don't work out.
David Glass.
So it doesn't make sense on Grand Avenue, it doesn't make sense on Rice Street, Arcade, Cesar Chavez, any other streets that the council and the mayor has put forward. This is just another example of the mayor and the city council shoving projects down the citizens of St. Paul's throats at the expense of local citizenry. Meanwhile, we're giving millionaires, the three richest guys in the state of Minnesota, a $100 million tax break over 20 years. Means, does it really make sense? I don't think it does. You know, we need to listen better to the citizens of St. Paul instead of talking down to them. We need to hear what they have to say, not only with regards to parking meters, but any of the other issues that come before us that affect us and business owners in the city of St. Paul. They haven't been doing that, ignoring us.
Any rebuttals? If not, we'll go on to question three, and in this order, David Sullivan Nightingale, David Glass, and then Amy Brenham Owen. How do you implement goals, equality, and community engagement within your election and on the response? And the topic is on police brutality, by the way. So, how do you implement goals, equality, and community engagement within your election and on the response? Does it help your support or make it questionable for police brutality concerns in this city?
Okay, I'm going to try to reiterate that here. How do I integrate
equality? I don't really understand the question at all.
Shall we bypass?
I think
I understand it.
Give your thoughts on.
Read it again, please.
How do you implement goals, equality, and community engagement within your election and on the response? Does it help your support or make it questionable for police brutality concerns in this city?
Okay. So one of the goals I was looking at was considering the goals of Black Lives Matter, because those are the ones that were fronted to the DFL. And they didn't come to our convention, but I took it seriously and read through the material, and it seems reasonable. And in fact, the President Obama, implemented some of those goals. Like not giving the police force main battle tanks. Doesn't make a whole lot of sense to give the police force main battle tanks or Bradley fighting vehicles. The police are not at war with the community, and the police don't want to be at war with the community. Secondly, I looked at all the engagement that BLM had previously with the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, and they weren't as engaged as some of our other community leaders, and that was unfortunate, because there's a lot of great leadership at the NAACP here in St. Paul, a lot of wisdom that could be gained. So I was trying to figure out and try to get a hold of them in order to sit down and talk with them, and they chose not to meet with me or any other member of the Independence Party, and I haven't gotten a response. So I've given them the opportunity, and I really wanted to listen to what they had to say. I also listened to what the police department had to say. And there's a lot of common ground there. And I looked at what my goals and the goals of the community were, and they're not incompatible. In fact, they're very compatible, and I think if we just sit down with each other and have a good long talk, a serious talk about race, a serious talk about racism and discrimination, and what we can do to fix it, we'll fix it. That's what I believe.
David Glass, next.
So I heard that question just a little bit differently, and so I might answer it just a bit differently. With regards to the election and my campaign, you know, I've always thought it was important to include everybody in Ward 5. Low voter turnout areas, which typically are disenfranchised, impoverished communities. And I needed, and even though I had well-meaning people on my strategy team from Ward 5 and said you have to focus on the west side of the, this is where all the voters are, it was important for me to walk the talk. And I spent a lot of time on the east side. I spent a lot of time in the north end. I spent a lot of time on Rice Street. And I spent time on the west side. But I've been in those, I've been in the apartments, and I've been having meet and greets in people's backyards all throughout the ward, meeting with folks from all different walks of life, from all different income levels, from all different communities, cultural backgrounds, and that's important for this campaign. Because if I'm blessed to be able to be elected to represent Ward 5, I'm gonna do the same thing at the city council. We're all there together as a community. We're not there just for one section of our community and one part of the city of St. Paul. In regards to my my friends at the St. Paul Police Force, and I'm honored that that they've endorsed me, and I'm told that this is the first time in their history that they pulled the endorsement from an incumbent and gave it to the challenger. You know, I respect the work that these folks do every day. And every day that I see a uniformed police officer, I walk up and thank them for the work that they do in our community, and I think everybody should do that. Are there some goofballs and bad apples in every industry and in every business that we have? But for the most part, our people in St. Paul, our folks in blue, do a fantastic job. I, for one, do not understand why anybody on the city council in the 6-10 years that I've been watching closely have never ever thanked the St. Paul Police Force publicly for the work that they do day in and day out keep us all straight.
Thank you, Amy. Brenda Moan.
Thank you. I will confess I'm still not 100% sure what we're asking with the question, but kind of going off what my challengers are saying, I guess I would like to say that the things that I'm seeing in the news that involve racial inequity, questionable police behavior, questionable crowd behavior, the reports in the paper about violence in schools, the mass shootings make me incredibly sad. They make me incredibly scared, and they make me feel hopeless sometimes. But in my job as a city council member, I feel like it's my responsibility to learn as much as I can, to understand where people are coming from and to try to figure out ways that I can connect and help in the very small purview that I have and try to expand it as much as I possibly can. To that end, I truly agree with Mr. Glass about enfranchising. I mean, I too, when I first campaigned, was startled at the difference in voter turnout from one side of the ward to the next, and have probably spent far, far too much time in a non-voting part of the ward because I just know how much that part of the ward needs help and investment, opportunities, education, support. The other morning I went to breakfast at a Ujamaa place, which is a nonprofit that works with young African-American men to prevent recidivism. They do counseling support, housing support, education support, and give folks hope and to get them on the right path. But in addition to that, I've been out with our police department in the field. I've went out with all three of the districts that are in Ward 5 and spent time with them one-on-one to understand what it's like to walk in their shoes and to get an understanding of how I can be supportive there. And also just in our own city services, like the library and rec centers, what are we doing there and how can we do better to close that gap and provide people the support and housing and hope that they need to walk the right path.
Okay, we have a rebuttal David Glass.
It's not a rebuttal as much as it is just a, a compliment. I want to recognize my friend and supporter, Officer Mark Ficadente, St. Paul Police Officer of the Year and Minnesota Police Officer of the Year. Mark, will you stand up, please? Mark's down here in front, and I'm proud of his friendship. I'm proud of his support. But I'm really proud of the work that the St. Paul Police continues to do. Mark got these awards because of his outreach in the community, the Somali community, the Karen community. And not only, Mark doesn't do this by himself, but so many of our other police officers have these different events throughout the summer, these little picnics, these hot dog deals they do at different parks around the city of St. Paul. They bring out the horses, and they have all kinds of events to make that outreach out to our communities. And I want to applaud them for taking those efforts. We do such a fantastic job, and we have some hiccups here and there. Yes, we do, but nothing compared to the rest of the larger cities across the country the size of St. Paul. And for St. Paul Police.
Any further rebuttals or comment? All right, the next question will be addressed by first David Glass, Amy Brennamone, and then David Sullivan Nightingale. What would you do to help St. Paul schools that are in crisis?
Boy, St. Paul schools are in crisis. You know, I was one of the first candidates to stand up and sign on with Caucus for Change. Caucus for Change is a movement that has grown rapidly since its inception of October, 2014. And the reason that it's become so popular is because what's happening in our St. Paul schools today is pretty appalling. I mean, just yesterday, a SRO over at Harding got punched in the face after a mealy. In our own community at Como Senior High, we've had three riots since school started. That's crazy. You know, what has been implemented by the superintendent and followed through by the school board is absolutely the wrong way to move with our kids. And when I'm knocking on doors, I'm hearing folks who are telling me that they think they're moving from St. Paul. They're sending their kids to other schools. Look, when we start losing high schools in our neighborhoods, we're starting to lose St. Paul. If I'm elected as a council person, I will work closely with school board members, especially in my ward, with schools to help bring them back up and pull together programs that affect all the citizens in not only our ward, but throughout St. Paul. All the schools are in trouble. And the mayor and the city council have yet to identify that we have a problem in St. Paul schools. They think we're going along swimmingly. Ask the parents who have students in our schools. They know we're in trouble.
Amy Brennamone.
Well, I have three boys in the St. Paul public schools, so I pay attention to what's going on in the school district, and I share concerns. I also share a lot of joy and excitement with what I hear coming back from both the elementary school, junior high, and high school that these boys are attending. I do know that the school board or the school district and the city of St. Paul are fairly separated when it comes to policy, and our overlap is really in after-school programming, and to an extent, our the way we connect with Sprockets and some of those programs. And I definitely think that we can always work harder on making or doing what we do and our overlap better. But I wanted to say that the large mob violence, which is terrifying, especially if it's something that you're present to see, is something that our police department has been working to stop for several years. When I first took office, there was a horrible incident after many of these riot fights where a young man, Ray Widstrom, was beaten within an inch of his life. And our police have worked very hard to be interrupters, to learn how to in partnership with our rec department, to be on site when they reading social media, they know something is going to happen, and try to break it up ahead of time, and have been successful in moving a lot of that violence out of our park system. So I guess the first thing I would do, because the word I heard is crisis, and I think in crisis it's great to talk about an election and a long-term change of our school board and our governance policy, but what we really need to do is get the school district working hand-in-hand with our incredible police department and figure out what has worked for us and what we can use from their successes to employ in our schools.
Thank you. Mr. Sullivan Nightingale.
Currently, my kids aren't in the public school system. They're homeschooled, so I wanted to disclose that so there's no secrets there. You know, my wife's a teacher and has been for many years. We support the public schools, and most of our neighborhood kids go to the public schools, and we want to see it improved. I went through Cherokee for a while on the west side, and the school's pretty rough back then, and they've improved considerably, but they've gone downhill, according to the parents I've talked to in the last few months, and you know, we would not put our kids in the public school system right now, and there's a good reason for that, and I think we do need new leadership, and I will be voting that new leadership personally on November 3rd, so.
Further comments? Mr. Glass?
So David Nightingale said it. He would not put his kids in St. Paul Public Schools today. I'm hearing that every day that I door knock, you know. And I take exception with the councilwoman, you know. This isn't just a St. Paul Schools and a St. Paul police problem. This is a St. Paul problem. This is a St. Paul council problem. This is a mayor's problem. The mayor backs our superintendent 100%. If I'm elected council member, one of the things that I propose is that we have two joint sessions between the council and the school board on an annual basis. And that's not just to meet in the morning and go home and say that we met, but we'll plan for it. Our team members will plan for it weeks in advance. We will meet for 2 days. We all come to the same pot of money, and it's called taxpayer dollars, right? It's funding all these things in the city of St. Paul. We need to work together to talk about how we are going to effectively provide for our kids in school.
Thank you. Any further comment or rebuttal? We'll move on. And this question will start with Ms. Brenna Moan, then David Sullivan Nightingale, and then David Glass. And the topic is affordable housing. How would you address the affordable housing issue, given that the North End and East Side neighborhoods in Ward 5 already have an overabundance of affordable housing?
So affordable housing is an important issue across the city, across the region, and particularly in Ward 5. And to the questioner, you have a great point. Our North End and our East Side neighborhoods have a lot of naturally affordable housing. I'm going to just point to one really specific example. When, as the chair of the Housing and Redevelopment Authority, I have some control over something that it's a scorecard for an allocation of tax credits. And the tax credits are worth about $10 million, and they're for low-income housing. When I was able to look at the scorecard and saw what proposals we'd funded in the past year, it seemed to me that we were continuing to invest money in areas that were already heavily occupied with affordable housing and low-income residents and not putting affordable housing in areas of means. And I wanted to have a scorecard that worked on improving existing affordable housing in areas that were challenged and renovating them. And we took out, I think the word was, we changed it to fully renovate instead of preserve. We're like, we don't want to just preserve it, we want it to be fabulous in that area. And then if there's going to be new money to new construction, it should go in an area that is not challenged, in an area where there's opportunities for folks to launch more easily. And we went from a 270-point scorecard to a 65-point scorecard that really weighted those two projects. And it's been very interesting in the first use of that card to see how that it changes the what kind of projects come in. I think it's very, very important that we provide affordable housing for folks, especially as our population ages. So it is a top priority. For the council, I can speak for most members of the council, it's a top priority for them, and a top priority to expand that housing into areas of means and to fully renovate it in areas where there's more challenges.
Mr. Sullivan Nightingale.
So I took stock in what kind of stock of housing we had, and we started out with about 2,000 vacant homes on the north end. And by the time Lee Helgen had finished, we were under 1,000. That's about an estimate. It's not precise. We're about 500 homes. Not all of them are affordable. Some of them are not habitable. And some of them are immediately habitable, which means a family could move in right away. And some of them are not on the market, which is a travesty, because they're just sitting there vacant and nobody knows about them. We need to engage the banks, the loan companies, to make sure that they're turning these houses over quickly and putting them on the market. We need to streamline that. We need to utilize all our veterans VASH vouchers this year so that we can put those homeless vets into those houses. And we need to make sure that the homes are safe by doing more frequent inspections to make sure they're up to speed, because they're dragging down the values in our neighborhoods. But that's what we need to do. Thank you.
Mr. Glass.
I sit on the board of the Minnesota Housing Partnership, and the partnership convenes, guides, and supports a diverse set of partners working to improve conditions of homes and community. They strengthen development capacity and promote policies that expand opportunity, especially for people at the lowest income levels. So I have a little experience here. In Ward 5, in certain areas of Ward 5, especially in the North End and East Payne-Phelan areas, you know, we have a surplus of affordable housing, and some of it's really in pretty poor shape, you know, and there's a variety of reasons for that. Folks who are buying this home sometimes are buying it through predatory lending practices, and they're unprepared for home ownership. You know? Some of the homes that are out there are cost overburdened to the family, meaning that the mortgage that they pay, they're paying over 30% of their income to keep a home, and it's a tough thing to do. We need to have a better mix of affordable housing and market rate housing throughout, especially the North End and Rice Street and the East Side. And when we do that, we'll have more stable housing. We'll have more stable neighborhoods. It's important, though, that we continue to encourage home ownership, because I believe that's really what is the basis for safe and stable neighborhoods. So we have some work to do. As David said, you know, it's coming down. But we still have a lot of work to do. Even on Dale Street, I'm hearing from neighbors that say that the renters over there, you know, many of the folks who own the homes don't live in St. Paul. They live out state, or they don't even live in the metro area, and their renters are bad actors. You know, they don't bring a whole lot of good things happening to our neighborhood. So we need to address that.
Thank you. Any further comment?
Yeah, I want to say it's hard to go first. Wow. I did want to say that we at the citywide peak, there were 2,400 homes vacant, and we're well under 1,000 today. I think they said at a recent budget meeting that about 300 or 400 is typical in a city our size. So we really are getting there. But the city's HRA has invested tens of millions of dollars in an Inspiring Communities program to get those boarded up homes back on the tax rolls and into homeowners and sometimes renters' hands. When it's renters, it's with caveats on that ownership, on the landlord to provide that affordable housing and maybe incentives for people to do some saving, save up for a down payment. So as I've been door knocking this season, I've noticed lots of less houses that are boarded up and lots of houses that have been fixed up and repaired and in critical areas that spur investment on the outside edges of that investment by the city's HRA. It's actually pretty exciting to see the improvements.
Any further? All right, for the next question, we would start with Mr. Sullivan Nightingale, then Mr. Glass, and Ms. Brennamon. Why did the City of St. Paul wait until the Black Bear Crossing lease ran out instead of breaking the lease, thus costing the city $800,000?
I can't answer that question, sorry. I don't know.
Mr. Glass.
Wow. So, I guess I'm not surprised that the Black Bear question comes up because periodically at the doors it comes up, but not all that often. You know, the fact of the matter is that the city of St. Paul asked Black Bear back in the year 1999 to put a plan in to do business at the Pavilion and invited us to do that. We did that, and they picked us and gave us a 10-year contract. In 2009, my wife and I were planning to leave the Pavilion to go on to our own new chapters in lives. My wife's a hard science teacher, and she was going to teach, and I was going to go on to do my economic development stuff with tribes and small businesses. 2009, we're just coming out of a recession, a tough recession, and the city came back and asked us again if we would sign up for another 10 years, and we actually said no. You know, after 4 days of constant asking, I finally said to the city, look, you guys, we really don't want to do this. If we even considered it, I'd rewrite the contract. And they said, well, let's see it. And I said, you're not going to like it. You know, you won't like this new contract. They said, let's do it. So I rewrote the contract, and I'm going to tell everybody, it was a sweetheart deal for Black Bear. It really was. That's not a lie. But the city had a contract. 5 years later, I had a discussion with Councilmember Brennan about a remodel that we were going to do. We drew up plans. I met with her and her boyfriend at the time, Mike, showed him the plans. And, you know, I'm mystified. I still don't know why the city did not let us continue in through 2018 with our lease. Multiple times throughout 2013, we agreed to changes in the contract. We were doing a remodel of $160,000, and it gets lost in the discussion. And so I'm not sure why. We won the case in court, and that's what I know.
Ms. Brennamon.
Well, I think first and foremost, it's important to point out that the new partner at the Como Lakeside Pavilion is an unqualified success, both financially and for the community. But the question that you're asking is about why the city didn't, that someone asks is why the city didn't wait 5 years instead of terminating the lease. I think it's important to clarify a few bits of misinformation shared by Mr. Glass. One is that the conversation about the lease started when Mr. Glass showed up asking for an extension of his loan for 10 years, or at least for 10 years, so he could secure a loan for a remodel. And I think at that time the city was interested in having some improvements to the space if there was going to be any talk of a lease extension. And it quickly devolved to, can you do a little more, just a little bit more? And the answer was, no, I'm going to sue you. It's unfortunate that this situation turned into an absolute three-ring circus. It could have been resolved in the conference room, but Mr. Glass wanted to resolve it in a courtroom. But the parties settled, and it is time to move on. I think we saw in the news reports a few weeks ago that You know, in the first 150 days in business, the Como Lakeside Pavilion's new vendor has generated over $1 million, of which 13% comes back to the city in the summer and 9% in the off season. I hear the term, it's just a bar, thrown around. I think that's lazy rhetoric. I was there yesterday for breakfast. It was a full service breakfast. There were seniors having coffee. There was grandparents with their kid. There's a packed room, a mom's group. I looked out the window and saw a pumpkin patch with a hayride, and I read a sign that there was an upcoming farmer's market. This place is alive. It's a community center, and folks are happy. Like I said, the party's settled. It's settled, and it's time to move on.
Hold your applause. Please hold your applause. The end of the forum is a time for applause, not during the questioning. And we have a rebuttal from Mr. Glass.
And I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this with conviction. Amy Brenmoen is a liar. All right?
No,
I can.
Mr. Glass.
Hold it.
Mr. Glass, please halt that line of questioning.
I have evidence that her and I started talking about this in October of 2012. I'll be more than happy to share that conversation, email, with anybody who'd like to see it. All right? I also have evidence, and you can pull it from Kevin Dukeshire's story at the Star and Tribune, that we attempted to settle this negotiation throughout the year of 2013. As late as November 15th, of 2013, we sat in a meeting with Amy, Mike, the attorney, and my attorney, and Nathaniel Kalik, and we thought we had an agreement. When we signed that agreement and sent it back in,
Thank
we were
you.
Told three
time.
Years, 3 days later,
That's time,
we didn't
please.
Have it.
Any further? Thank you. On the next question, Mr. Glass will go first, Ms. Brenneman, and then Mr. Sullivan Nightingale. As an elected council member following the election, how will you work with the mayor and the rest of the city council to keep the focus and investment in Ward 5?
Could you read that again, please?
As an elected council member, how will you work with the mayor and the rest of the council to keep the focus and investments into Ward 5?
Great question, because we haven't been doing that for the last 3.5 years. All of a sudden, and this, at the end of the, as we get near an election cycle, we have all this kind of money that now is coming into Ward 5. For 3.5 years, we've had nothing going on. Take a look at Rye Street in the North End. Absolutely no investment. Meanwhile, the downtown area has spent something like $240 million worth of investment. All of the money that we're spending in the city of St. Paul is happening downtown. Nothing is happening here in Ward 5. You know, Councilmember Brenwell, when she ran last time, said that she was going to make sure that the investment and the work didn't stop at the central corridor, that it would come into Ward 5. We're still waiting for that to happen. The kinds of things that she talks about here tonight, Willow, the housing on Maryland and Western, at the old Larson Greenery, the money that's supposedly coming up into Railroad Island, dollars over at Front and Dale, we haven't seen any of that yet. The talk is cheap. And what she's been doing in Ward 5 from the very beginning is there's been a lot of talk with no action. So as a city council person with my business expertise and my ability to network and my relationship building, I'll be able to make those deals happen. I'll be a cheerleader here for Ward 5, for Rice Street and North End to make things happen.
Ms. Brenneman?
Well, I'm thrilled about all the things that are happening in Ward 5, and I actually agree a little bit with Mr. Glass that it takes a little while to build something when there's really nothing in the pipeline. When I started in 4 years ago, there was very little that was like in the queue for me to do. So stuff does take a little time to come to fruition. But that said, my aide Kim and I sat down and started writing a list of achievements and not just monetary projects, of which there are many, but you know, small accomplishments, and we ended up having to like cut and cut and cut on a piece of paper because there was too much great stuff. Things in the rec department, like getting the Wilder Rec Center staff and programming doubled and tripled, getting a new play area funded for Marydale Park. The Sylvan Play Area, in partnership with District 6, will have a brand new soccer field of more than $1 million in investment there. We've got money for the North End Economic Development Fund. Worked very hard to secure a police training facility in Ward 5, and I'm excited to see that planning is also underway. We have the Rice Street Library went under renovation. We got the largest award for STAR grants for a new Bangkok Thai deli on Rice Street. Just very recently, the city established a commercial vitality zone fund, and we secured a third of one of the first pots of money to invest at the Como and Front and Dale intersection, thanks to some of the work that District 6 Council did to identify that as a commercial zone, and work was started on that this fall. And in addition to that, well, we talked about the Habitat for Humanity development. That project, you know, shovels in the ground in next year, but that's a project that we're currently working on and designing to make sure that we can meet the needs for the people who live in that who will live in those habitat homes. But exciting stuff is happening all over, from rain gardens to community gardens to murals and public art. It's exciting time in Ward 5.
Mr. Sullivan Nightingale.
Well, I've had an opportunity to work with a lot of executive leaders in government. And I can't say that I've worked with a mayor before, but I've worked with quite a few generals at the Pentagon. And let me tell you, there's a lot of prima donnas out there. Mayor Coleman is not like that, actually. He's a different kind of leader. He needs encouragement sometimes. And I would take him on a tour of the North End, and we used to call this the leadership walk. It means you go through and you stick your nose where you usually don't like to stick it, where you're going to find problems, where you're going to find trouble, and you're going to go out looking for it, and you're going to find trouble when you do this. That means we need to visit the Jefferson Smurfit site, which has been sitting vacant for far too long. We will turn that from a long-term goal into a short-term goal, and I know the District 6 Planning Council would really like that. We also need to do walkthroughs where people live. We have a lot of hazards on the North End, and some of them are getting fixed, but we're learning the hard way. We need to be learning the easy way by getting our boots dirty, getting our boots on the ground, and doing a walkthrough some of these apartments and visiting people. You know, my pastor has been through hell and back, and he's told me a lot about his visits to his communities into the Chicago area when he was a young minister. And he's been in some terrible places. We need leaders like that to get into places where, quite frankly, many of us in this room don't want to go, or where the police go every day. And you want to go in some of those places, too, let me tell you. But the fact of the matter is, we need to look out for our neighbors. And that means occasionally helping them along and, you know, finding out what their problems are, what's really going on in their lives, and helping them fix it. But that's what we need to do with Mayor Coleman. Thanks.
Anything further? Ms. Brennemann?
I think I got so excited to talk about the list of accomplishments that I forgot that really your question was about your relationship with the mayor and the administration, deputy mayor, and your council colleagues. I want to just be clear, I am definitely not someone who I would describe as a cheerleader. I do dig in and do the work. Thanks for reminding me about this. With the mayor and the deputy mayor and the new chief of staff and my colleagues, I make regular effort to meet with them and walk them around the ward, and even took some of my colleagues on bike rides around the ward to get kind of a slower speed observation of what our challenges are and what our successes are. And I think that in order to be successful in this city as a council member and a strong mayor system, that it is important to build strong relationships with the administration and know when to fight and know when to compromise, because you really can't get anything done if everything you do is a fight.
Any further rebuttal? And on this question, Ms. Brenamone will go first, Mr. Sullivan Nightingale, and then Mr. Glass. What will you do to bring more transparency and accountability in the city?
Well, that's a good question. I think that the goal is always to have processes be as transparent as possible. I was mentioning earlier when we talked about the Grand Avenue parking meters, I think even the mayor's office is agreeing they bungled that process. But in order for anything to be successful, it's very important that there's buy-in from the stakeholders. A great example of that and a process that I thought was wonderfully transparent was the proposal at the Willow Reserve or Maryland Home site. We had a site that had sat vacant for many, many years in anticipation of a 30 to 40 unit walk-up apartment building, and had the opportunity for the city to take over that parcel of land and to work with the community to determine what we wanted to build at that site. We set up a community-based steering committee. The steering committee put together an RFI, a request for interest. We sent out the request for interest and got proposals back in. When we reviewed all the proposals, the community members said, "We don't like any of the proposals." So we decided rather than try to move forward without buy-in, we would go back to the drawing board. I personally reached out to Sue Haig to talk to her about bringing Habitat for Humanity in. And they were very excited about the prospect of having home ownership, which is what the neighbors in the community wanted to see in that location. Ownership that could be accessible, built on accessible ownership that could be for larger families. And they met with the community and the community was bought in. We are moving forward with that project next spring. We'll do it a few houses at a time, and one of the things I'm really excited about with Habitat is their penchant for really getting community involved and doing some needed community building around that housing project in the North End. And I thought that was a great example of getting buy-in and having transparency from the get-go.
Mr. Sullivan, Nightingale.
There's something that we do in private industry, which isn't always done in government. And one of the most important things that was implemented a few years ago within the federal government is quality assurance programs. And the independence of quality assurance programs mean that we define goals, measure them, analyze, improve, and control risks independently of agencies and activities that we're trying to provide oversight over. And I think that's an important thing missing from state and local government today, including our government. And while the city council is supposed to be doing this, they may not always be equipped to do this activity. So I would institute independent oversight over quality and safety. I would also revise data retention policies to align better best practices in government and industry, and we can do this. I have a degree in electrical engineering field of study, so yeah, I can certainly help. Data retention policies are not foreign to the state government. They currently do a good job in some departments. Even our universities have data retention policies. I don't know why we can't align with some of the best practices in industry today. But for accountability, and it's the primary role of the city council to hold the city services accountable for their actions. And that's what I would do, and I have experience doing that.
Thank you, Mr. Glass.
Transparency and accountability. Two things that are lacking at City Hall today, along with a host of others, integrity, honesty. You know, today, most of the work that's done by the city council and votes taken are done on a Wednesday afternoon at a closed session and with a consent agenda. So everything is put into this consent agenda, the council passes it, the only people that can bring a certain item out of the consent agenda would be the council member, and then they're the only people who can talk about it. So if you're there as a private citizen of the city of St. Paul, you wouldn't be able to speak to the issue at all. That's the way we do business today. Most of the work that we've done with regards to the MLS stadium, parkland dedication dollars, bike lanes, grand round design, emails, the list goes on, parking meters, etc. These are all decisions that have been made behind closed doors. There's been no, and we're lucky when the newspaper decides to report on them, if they even find out about it. You know, consent agendas are supposed to be to expedite the conduct of routine business in order to allocate more meeting time to discussion of substantive issues. Consent agenda items should be routine matters that are non-controversial. We have it backwards here at the City of St. Paul in our council with the mayor. We really do. You know, we can do better and we should do better. The St. Paul Strong, which is which just announced their platform last week, is all about ethics, responsibility, accountability, transparency, honesty, and government. My good friend Ruby Hunt, 91-year-old, 10 years on the city council, president, our city charter, she was the author, she agrees with me.
Thank you. Any further? Ms. Brenneman.
I agree that transparency is incredibly important, but I am going to take a moment to correct some misinformation again from Mr. Glass. First of all, there are no closed council sessions at 3:30 on Wednesdays. There are open council sessions at 3:30 on Wednesdays where we do mundane city business. Every other Wednesday at 5:30, we have open public hearings where we tackle the more controversial items, and they're open to the public. Items that go on the consent agenda are supposed to be items where there is no controversy. There are times when items end up on the consent agenda that don't belong on the consent agenda and they're removed. So if there are settlements from our HR department for workers' comp, they might be on the consent agenda. If it's a it's usually just some minor transaction will be on the consent agenda. So, but even that meeting isn't a closed meeting.
Hi. Mr. Glass.
So, I mentioned Ruby Hunt, president of the city council back in the 70s. She was the author of the city charter that we are governed by today, city council and mayor. You only have to Google Ruby Hunt's name in the Pioneer Press and go back to the editorial that she wrote some 4 or 5 months ago discussing the role of the city council with regards to transparency and the work that they're doing. And she took them to task for not doing the work with regards to the charter and the kinds of things that they should be doing in terms of auditing, investigating, and holding the mayor accountable. So I would challenge you to go take a look at that article from Ruby and make your own opinions.
Thank you. I'm afraid that's all the questions we'll be able to get to, and we got through only a small fraction of those you turned in. I will be reading every one of the questions that we didn't ask at the following the closing statements. So shall we begin the closing statements? Ms. Brenneman will go first.
Okay. Are we, is that clock run?
Will we go to 8:30? Pardon me? Questions until 8. All right, we will go till 8:30.
I'm happy to wrap.
Then the next question that I had.
Sorry, kids.
You're in a hurry to go watch the other debate.
Okay. All right, I found it. And Mr. Sullivan Nightingale will go first, then Mr. Glass and Ms. Brenneman. What is your position on a Major League Soccer stadium in St. Paul? And would you work to have a women's team in St. Paul as well as a men's team?
I studied this about a month ago when a book came out about stadiums nationwide, and not all stadiums are created equal. Each is in its own environment and has its own dynamics and its own economies of the city. Where this stadium is located, I'm not sure it's a good design to put a large stadium like this at a major intersection. That being said, I don't like the idea of giving tax breaks based off of size of the company that you're running. So I don't agree with giving tax breaks to bigger companies over little companies. In fact, that's not the Independence Party position. That's not my position. I believe in treating each company fairly and equitably, and I don't think that's a good policy for us to be doing it. That being said, I do think we need to invest in soccer equally for both men and women, and not just soccer, but other team sports here in the Twin Cities. We need to encourage women to exercise and to participate. We've been discouraging them for far too long. I think that's deplorable. It's a problem that affects us in the military, where we don't have men and women coming out of the public school system that have the same type of physical training. I think we need to work on Title IX issues across the board, and that needs to apply to professional sports all the way down to preschool. You know, we need to implement programs that encourage women to participate in sports and games just as much as we do the men.
Mr. Glass.
So Mr. Nightingale Sullivan brought up the fact that there was a study done that talked about the different major league teams that we're going to have here in the state of Minnesota. I think it's a issue that we really need to discuss and take a look at. You know, in economies, in the economic world, there's a saying called, there's a term called marginal returns. You know, we are going to reach a certain saturation point with a major league teams here in the metro area that it's just going to become unsustainable for some, right? That's going to happen. Having said that, you know, I said this to Bill McGuire at a dais that we had about 2 months back. I said it at the hearing or the screening we had at the Strib a couple weeks ago, that if the city of St. Paul is going to push ahead and do this project and give a tax break to the three wealthiest men in the state of Minnesota to the tune of $100 million over 20 years, we need to get something back in return. Really, they need to give back. And what I suggested to Bill McGuire is that they build 10 new soccer stadiums for our youth in the most disenfranchised, impoverished areas of the city, outfit them, put nets up, balls, hold clinics, classes, build their fan base from the bottom up, and then every year build two more. That's not a lot of money for these guys, especially with the kind of tax breaks they're getting. Meanwhile, we're not giving any tax breaks or providing any dollars to small business growth in this city. You know, the really good thing would have done to have some business planning and do a feasibility study to understand, you know, the future and in what the market is with regards to all these teams. We didn't do that.
Ms. Brennemong.
Well, I have to start by saying that I'm really proud of our Como High School boys soccer team. When I read that they, just the team that they had and the multiple cultures represented on the team, the multiple languages spoken, and the successes they were having, I was sucked in and so proud when they won the state tournament and continue to be a leader in soccer, actually for boys and girls at the school. And I'm also really pleased that we were able to secure funding with CIB to redo the field at Sylvan, potentially even with synthetic synthetic field so that it can be used earlier and later in the spring. I don't drive past there without seeing kids from all walks of life out playing and enjoying themselves. I see it as an accessible sport, cross-cultural sport, and a real bridger, and something that brings us together. As far as the MLS stadium, my understanding is that the bus barn site has been off the tax rolls for 50 years. And the city council participated in a vote saying that we would be supportive of a stadium on that site, which include the only request that we have heard is to take 10 acres of the 35-acre site and keep them off, they're untaxed. But the council resolution said that in exchange for that, that the other 25 acres would need to be activated and fully on the tax rolls and part of a thriving development project there. Of course, I'm not a fan of tax breaks for the privileged, but I also think that to the extent I know this deal, this would activate a site that's been vacant forever. And it's in a wonderful location, and the idea of bringing soccer and bringing that area to life is very exciting to me. And I think the devil will be in the details. We want to do a good deal. We want to do a deal that doesn't cost the taxpayers a ton of money, but also brings a lot of benefit to both that stadium area and the surrounding acreage that will be activated.
Thank you. Any further, Mr. Glass?
I'm just going to say, the tax breaks isn't the only thing that's going to cost the city of St. Paul the taxpayers. If the stadium goes in, the infrastructure rebuild over there, parking ramps that is going to have to be picked up by the city of St. Paul, we're going to be in the hundreds of millions of dollars. It's just, you can't plop a stadium down on that site and pretend that it doesn't need anything else. City of St. Paul has a reputation of not doing any kind of business planning with any of these projects that are huge, that cost us money, and then they continually have cost overruns. CHS Stadium, Midway Stadium, the Saints Stadium is one of those projects that has a cost overrun of near $30 million.
Any further rebuttal?
I would have one thing to add. If we do have a stadium there, I strongly suggest putting an outdoor hockey rink in during the winter time, because if we're going to use it, we might as well use it for our favorite sport here in Minnesota.
Any more? Okay. And this question, we'll start with David Glass. Second, Amy Brennemowen. Third, David Sullivan Nightingale. And the topic is teamwork respect. Can you each say something positive about your opponents?
Respect? Well, let me start with the gentleman to my right, David Nightingale Sullivan. I've never met David before, and I met him for the first time at the Star Tribune offices, and he was he's very engaging and a gentleman, and I appreciate his background and his schooling and the issues that he wants to tackle as he campaigns, and he seems to be well-meaning and a nice. Just a nice guy. I met his parents on the Rice Street Parade, and his mother at first wouldn't shake my hand. She said, "My son's running against you." And I said to his father, I said, "Well, I wish him the best of luck." And he looked at me, he said, "You mean that?" And I said, "Yeah, I mean that. I wish him the best of luck. I mean, this is an easy thing to do. I've never done this before in this kind of way." So, Ms. Brennemowen, Ms. Brennemowen talks about the hard knocks that she had growing up, and I understand that. I get that. And being able to pull herself up and be where she is today, that, I give her credit for that and applaud that. And I wish her the best of luck in whatever that she pursues, if she's elected again or if she goes on to do something else.
Ms. Brennemowen.
Thanks for this question. I actually try to make a habit of finding things that I like and respect about people that I work with all the time. I think it's helpful in politics, especially where things can get challenging and tense sometimes.
I'll start with Mr. Glass. One thing that I have always really admired about him is his clear love, respect, and admiration for his wife. I see again and again in written material how he brings her name to the forefront and talks about how they work as a team and a partnership, and I think that that's a wonderful thing, and I think and hope he understands how important it is for people to have a life partner that's a partner with them, and so I respect that and I like that. Other David, Nightingale Sullivan, I really admire your enthusiasm. I admire you for sticking your neck out. Running for office is a very challenging thing. And I've listened to some of your ideas, and I feel whatever the outcome of this election is, there's some things in there that I really think are important, particularly your observation about the large wards we serve. I mean, our council wards are about two-thirds the size of the city of Duluth. It's a huge number of people, and I even, you know, I hear sometimes people say, oh, I haven't seen my council member on my door before. It's like, gosh, I know, you know, Lee and Janice and Jim and everybody, and you guys too, we're all out there knocking, but you just can't get to every door and see people, and they're there every time. It's just a lot of folks. So I think that's great. I think that we need to think about the way our wards are divided, and that's just one example of things I think would be great for you to continue to push forward and work with, regardless of the outcome of this election.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I really admire the way Dave Glass has advocated for the Native American community, not just here in Minnesota, but nationally. And in areas where we as a nation have neglected, such as the schools, such as using Native Americans as mascots is demeaning. And for him to continuously do that over the years is a great service to our nation, not just locally, but nationally.
Thank you.
And Amy, how much I enjoy your enthusiasm regarding pedestrian safety, especially on Rice Street, and how important that is to us, being pedestrians, most of us. And we look forward to what remains this year. Hopefully we can get some action done, and I think we're going to do that. So I'm very excited about your enthusiasm with regard to pedestrian safety.
I would ask for rebuttals, but I don't think there any need to be called for. The next question will go first to Amy Brennamone, second to Mr. Sullivan Nightingale, and third to Mr. Glass. While street repairs are needed desperately, it seems to be taking a long time to complete them. Examples include Front and the streets south of Lake Como. What should be done to minimize disruption to local neighborhoods?
Well, last year after the winter we had, our streets were in incredibly bad condition. We had to reorganize our city budget, actually, to make room for what we call the Terrible 20, which is just roads that were absolutely impassable, and that's something where my strong relationships with council members helped change our city budget to prioritize funding on rebuilding our crumbling street infrastructure. And, of course, you know, it's either pothole season or repair season, and now that we're in full repair season and there's projects all over the place, including right outside my front door, you know, it's disruptive, and we're doing the best that we can to make sure that people are informed of these repairs and changes that are happening. I think that we made some important shifts in our last budget year and moved some of our arterial streets to the top of the list and moved our residential streets down a little bit because it was clear that our arterial streets were taking more of a beating than we thought they were going to, or than the Public Works had planned for. So the City Council and the Mayor's Office has prioritized street repairs. I don't really remember the end part of the question was about informing people.
Minimize disruption to the local neighborhoods?
Yeah. Well, and just as an example, today we were meeting with the Yerussos and the Morellis for a project that we're going to be doing at Bedford and Payne Avenue. Anyone who's been to Morellis knows there's a traffic traffic problem at that intersection, or a traffic awesomeness if you're Jimmy Morelli. But we talked to them very much about how we were going to continue to make sure that their businesses were open and thriving during the construction process we had in front of us, and made sure that they have a liaison so that they can communicate clearly when is the best time to move forward with different aspects of the project.
Mr. Sullivan Nightingale.
So there's some long-term and short-term solutions to these problems. The long-term solution is to buy, procure, and design more reliable road systems. That's the long-term solution. That means you got to spend a lot more money up front, but in the long run, you'll return your investment. In the short term, we can continue to do the city just came up with this year, and its redesign of how it maintains the roads. There's been some improvements with the mill and overlay process, capitalize on that. But also we need to hedge out on the materials early on and get other cities involved and assess what our needs are ahead of time so we can plan ahead as much as we can to buy in bulk the materials we need to repair the roads. Now, the city's already trying to do this. It's a very difficult job, but I think it'd be a lot easier if we cooperate with the surrounding cities to buy materials to take advantage of economies of scale with regard to our collective purchasing power, and that would help reduce the total cost. And to reduce disruption, getting feedback from the locals, making sure that's part of a checklist process that our public services go through to make sure that we know when people are going to be coming or going, where most of the customers are coming in from, and redirecting them on alternate routes. And that's all. Thanks.
Mr. Glass.
Roads. We have the worst roads that we've had in the past 20 years. Just drive them, you'll agree. There hasn't been any real planning regarding a plan for fixing the infrastructure in St. Paul. No one's talked about it. The mayor doesn't. The only thing that we've ever heard about is what was it called, Amy? The 20-something? Where we're doing a Band-Aid to fix some of the roads in St. Paul because of such a horrendous winter. Well, Minnesota has horrendous winters. We haven't done very good planning in terms of providing for the infrastructure. You know, when I'm out door knocking, you know, just 2 weeks ago, I was knocking on a door in the North End. One of the guys who opened, a gentleman opened the door, he started talking to me. He works for Public Works. He started asking me about how taxes are spent. He hasn't seen a street cleaner in the North End in years, you know. On the street. He hasn't seen preventative maintenance done on the streets in years. But he works for Public Works, and he does clean the streets, and he's doing it over in more affluent areas of the city of St. Paul. That's just not right. Not true. You know, our tax dollars should spend equally across the board. In a story that the St. Paul Pioneer Press wrote about maybe 2 months ago with regards to the new Public Works Director, Kathy Lantry, and the aide that she hired, one of the comments in there and quotes were that the Public Works has the lowest morale that they've had in years, partly due to the cutbacks in the services that they're providing or not providing anymore. They're not doing preventative maintenance on the streets. They're not doing the street cleaning on the streets. And we have a continued deterioration in our infrastructure. A new council and the mayor and a new mayor need to spend a lot of time in determining how we fix and put together new roads infrastructure for the city of St. Paul.
Rebuttals? Ms. Brennan-Mohan?
Yeah, I guess I would like to say something, just FYI. I am really excited about the mayor's very tactical and bold choice to hire former council president Kathy Lantry as a director of public works. That woman is a dynamo, firecracker, great thinker, and an excellent leader for an organization that's basically a large group of engineers.
I would say that we are in for a wonderful future in our public works infrastructure, and speaking of planning, I think that the morale that Mr. Glass was referring to is old news. The staff is excited to work under Kathy's leadership and the way that she's been able to communicate complex plans and funding difficulties and ideas for improvement is wonderful, and I think we're in very good hands, and I'm excited to work with Kathy Lantry.
And Mr. Glass.
Well, I just have to respond to this. You know, the mayor hired a person who didn't meet any of the qualifications of the job requirements for a major department in the city of St. Paul. One of the things that the job required was an engineer's degree. Kathy Lantry met none of those. In fact, they spent already somewhere around $13,000 with headhunters and doing interviews, and they were flying in a public works director, a female from some suburb of Chicago, for an interview when the mayor decided that Kathy Lantry was the person for the job. And go figure. How does she then hire anybody else in her department and hold them to different expectations than she was held to? It wouldn't happen in the private sector the same way that it happened here.
Thank you. And that will have to be the last question, but I will read the rest of them at the end. And so now we will turn to the candidates' closing statements, and the first one to go is Amy Brenamone.
Well, thank you so much again, everyone, for being here tonight. There's about five times more people here than there was the first time I ran, so this is an incredible group. The questions have been challenging, interesting. It's fun to hear from my challengers. I want to say again that I've met with you, I've listened to you, I've really enjoyed having the opportunity to celebrate you and collaborate with you and help problem solve. It is truly, truly an honor to serve in City Council, and especially with this incredible, diverse, and wonderful ward. I am so proud of what we've done, and I'm proud of what we're doing, and I'm proud of what we're going to be doing. I was looking around today at people, and I looked at Marnie Zhang, and I'm so excited to continue working with you to engage communities of color. Your enthusiasm for this are just heartwarming to me, and I really want to dig in and work harder with you. And I look next to her and see Darren McDonald, who serves on our police force, and you've been a wonderful friend and advocate. I loved our ride along together. It taught me so much about the perspective from the police, and I want to continue to learn and grow with you. I look over and I see Rich Holst, and I know how much you care about bikeability and livability and walkability and making the North End and the rest of our neighborhood wonderful, and I want to continue to work with you. I see Todd Dahlstrom, and I know that we're going to sit down and talk about potential projects in our community, including a large grocer, and how do we thread the needle with the needs of our unions. I'm excited about that. This community I've met is wonderful. Like I said, every day is a challenge and every day is an adventure, and I have delivered on my promises, but I'm not done yet. I'm seeking a second term. I want to build on the momentum that we have made, and I don't want to stop until every neighborhood is livable, every neighborhood is vibrant, and every neighborhood is safe. Please vote for me, Amy Brenamone, on November 3rd in the election. There's more information at my website at www.amyforcitycouncil.com.
Thank you. David Glass.
Well, thanks to the St. Paul League of Women Voters and District 6 Planning Council for holding this candidates forum this evening for Ward 5 and us candidates. At the end of the day, we all need to decide who we're going to vote for to represent Ward 5 in the city of St. Paul. This job requires someone who is good at relationship building and with multiple constituencies. It requires building good relations with constituents, elected officials at all levels, business interests, both small and large, and a myriad of others. I have those skills. I'm a bridge builder and a collaborator and bring certain business expertise to the table. Taking a risk of getting into the restaurant business and being successful at it for almost 20 years didn't happen by accident. The city of St. Paul, with all of its projects and challenges it's facing in the future and in addressing its infrastructure, needs someone who's going to push for sound business planning. I will be that person. The renaissance of Rice Street will happen because someone will become the cheerleader and bring all the resources together with business owners and residents to dialogue and make that happen. I will be that person. Our youth and families need an advocate addressing recreation centers, open space, safe schools, where we really address the achievement gap and provide for all. I will be that person and advocate. Ask those who know me. Come call some of the nonprofits I've spoke of. Ask the Minneapolis and University of Minnesota Police. I led a 5,000-person rally last November at TCF Stadium, incident-free. That was our stated goal, and we did it. It was the largest rally in sports history. Ask any and all of them, and they'll tell you I get things done. My wife, Pam, and I worked through some difficult, down economic times and came out of the other side okay. Through it all, we always kept its focus on our commitment to community and being able to provide those who needed a second or third chance at a job when other business said no thank you allowed me to live my values and give back. I wouldn't be here tonight if others hadn't provided me with those same opportunities. Lastly, I'll say, please vote for me as your first choice on November 3rd. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sullivan Nightingale.
Thank you to the District 6 Planning Council and the League of Women Voters for hosting tonight. When I look around this room tonight, I see all the people, all the things we've built in our community over the years. You know, I've listened to the stories of my grandfather telling me what life was like in St. Paul 100 years ago and how far we've come. You know, I imagine South Robert Trail just being a dirt road, Speed Holman zipping around the high bridge doing loop-de-loops, and how far we've come today. Looking in this room today and all the people that are in it, we've built a great civilization. We can do great things when we work together. Looking at this room, y'all built this school for our children. Look at this magnificent building. This is for our kids. This is the kind of future we want to continue in St. Paul. And it works really well when we plan ahead, when we design these things ahead of time. I'm an engineer and I like to dream. But I can turn dreams into reality. But I need people's help. I mean, we need to all work together to build our future. And I think it looks pretty bright regardless. Our democracy is very strong. And it's great to see all of you out here participating in that democracy that I and my classmates have fought so very hard for. It means a lot. It means a lot to know that our liberties are secure because you're participating in this democratic process. And I hope you'll see that my qualifications will help me help you build an even better civilization. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates.